diesel depots, the heart of traction maintenance. The place where locomotive fleets are restored and maintained. Housing everything required from inspection pits, refueling points, and site offices. Join the Hornby magazine team as they embark on building a brand new 00 gauge model railway.
When was it a good idea to build a layout outside in January?
In Key Model World's latest multi-part build series.
I think the most important thing now is to start playing trains.
Playing trains?
Or testing, sorry.
Sorry, testing. Testing.
Building a diesel depot.
So hello and welcome once again to the latest Hornby magazine multi-part layout build series. Today we bring you a brand new diesel depot layout, which is based on Stratford Diesel Depot, although we're calling it Natford.
Because it's not Stratford.
Yeah. So Mark, tell us a bit more about the depot.
So the depot, as you can see behind us, is, you quite rightly said, based on Stratford Depot. And we've had created a very special kit, exclusive to Key Publishing. It's available in two parts. Option A is the four-road through shed, which is at the front of the depot here. And then we've also got option B, which is also four-road through shed, but with offices.
And that's, for me, really the exciting part about this layout build series, is you yourself can buy the kit at home and build your own diesel depot.
Absolutely, and it can look superb like this.
And on top of this multi-part video series, we have so much content lined up for you.
We do. In the latest issue, the April 2023 issue of Hornby magazine, we've got an overview of the diesel depot behind us. And in the May 2023 issue, we're going to have a full in-detail look at the diesel depot kit itself.
Right, I think we better start and start right back at the beginning with baseboards. And we'll go and join Mike now, who's outside putting this layout together.
Tony's Trains of Rugby is located at Hillmorton Locks on the outskirts of Rugby. We are open Tuesday to Saturday 10 till 5 but closing early on Saturday at 4 o'clock. We stock Hornby Backman, Graham Farish, Pico, Gauge Master, Haljan, Oxford and Oxford Diecast, Acura Scale and more. We also have a large selection of second hand models to suit all budgets. You can either visit us in store or reach me on 01788 543 442. Visit our website tonystrainsofrugby.com or find us on Facebook.
So we've moved to Heath Robinson HQ and we're ready to start building baseboards for our brand new diesel depot layout. I've got all the materials around me, so I've got my planed 18mm by 70mm, 2.4 metre lengths of timber to make the baseboard frames. Just behind me in the shed tucked away are the 9mm plywood sheets. Got the tools to hand on one side, I've got my bench saw to cut the planed timber as well, and I'm ready to start marking everything out, building some baseboards and get ready to move this layout project forward. Right. Off we go. Hopefully they won't bore you as much as I appear to have done with Luna, who's given up on baseboards by the look of it. But what I want to do is talk through how the baseboards come together. So each one's made out of 6 pieces of planed timber plus the 9mm plywood for the top. I chose the 18mm by 70mm timber, so it's deep enough to house a DCC Concepts cobalt point motor inside the frame as well, without it getting damaged at the bottom. Also means there's plenty of space for wiring in there as well. Essentially, those 6 pieces, they're all cut out of 2 lengths of a 2.4 metre length of this timber. So 2 long pieces for the sides, which are 1,220mm long. Then 4 pieces for the cross braces, which are 568mm long, to suit the width of this baseboard, which is 605mm wide. Those are all then cut. I've joined them all together as a frame before I put the top on, but I've left the cross braces separate at one side, so I've got a little bit of flexibility in the frame just in case I need to adjust it to fit perfectly square against the baseboard top. So once I've screwed the frame together, I then put the top on top of it, and I can screw all that in place, make sure it's all fixed in place perfectly square around all the corners. Then I can secure those cross braces in place at the other side as well, and then drawing the lines across the top which show where the cross braces are, screw those in place, and I've got a nice solid top ready to use baseboard. So I've marked out the depot onto the baseboard now, and figured out all the sizes and shapes of where it's going to be. My original plan was, I was thinking actually that this board would not be the depot building, this would be the entry roads to it. But I think now, having thought about it, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take out this cross brace across here, just undo the screws from it, one of the advantages of not having glued it in place. And then I can just move it forward by 3 inches so it'll sit outside the frame of the actual depot building, which means that then we can come back later on in the build and we can cut out inspection pit holes to run in this first section of the shed here. And then we can have raised walkways either side of that as well. So you have that view when you look inside the depot, that the pits drop down underneath the locomotives and you've got the raised walkways either side as well. I think that'll look quite effective inside here. And it's all going to be code 75 track as well, so it should look really smart. We've looked at quite a few options of how we can do this interior. We've looked at using the West Hill Wagon Works drop floor, which has got all the supports to do that, but it works with code 100 track. And all our track here today is going to be code 75. So we've made a choice, and hopefully the result looks good. So we've completed construction of the 2 baseboard frames, and they're all topped out as well. We've now joined them together as well. So these can now be separated and taken apart as we need them to be as well. So what I've done is they've got 6mm coach bolts running through each side between the 2 boards. And then I've also drilled the extra holes in the centres to allow us to put alignment dowels in as well. So those alignment dowels will mean that when we bring these 2 baseboards together, the alignment dowels will just lock straight into place, which means we've got really accurate alignment each time we put the baseboards together as well. This being one of those layouts that's going to be portable, it's going to be set up and set down, so it's important that we can easily put this together and take it apart again as well. So the main tools for this part of the process are an electric drill and a set of drills. I use wood bits for all the work on here. So I've got a 7mm wood bit, which I use to put the coach bolt holes through. Using the 7mm hole means I've got a slight bit of clearance for the 6mm bolts to go through. And then for the alignment dowels, I use a 25mm face drill for the low cut into the face of the timber, which takes the face of the alignment dowel. Then I use a 13mm spade bit to put the hole all the way through. Now, prior to doing either of those holes, I put a pilot hole through with the 3mm drill. That just means that each time I use a different drill, it's centered on the same place and it will run through in the same alignments as well. Right, next, I should really build a storage yard board, but what I really want to do is get some track down. So I'm going to go and find some track. We'll start mocking up this layout and see how it's going to look.
Hi, I'm Alex Yates, and this is TMC, the Model Centre at Beckhall near Whitby. We're down at the new mailroom at TMC, where we can ship your orders worldwide. Here at TMC, we do many limited editions. We've got our 24.5-tonne mineral wagons that have just come into stock, and we've got our G5 that is due in summer next year, and we've got many other limited editions available on our website. Here at TMC, we stock all major brands, including Hornby and Backman, and we also have a large range of pre-owned models, all available in-store and on our website. We offer customisation services when you buy a model from us, such as Real Coal, Cab Crew, DCC Sound, DCC, and any little customisation features that you want on your models. We also offer a weathering service. When you buy a model off our website, we have tick box options, so you can spec up the model as much or as little as you want. You can pre-order all future releases on our website with free postage over £50 and no deposit required. Whether you're a customer, old or new, visit us in person or visit our website, themodelcentre.com. We hope to see you soon.
I've seen you've brought out a loco and track, so I've appeared.
You've appeared because the loco's here or the track's here.
Well, bit of both.
We've also got some buildings as well. So this is the, I suppose, the raw ingredients for what's going to go together to make this layout now start to come to life. This is going to be a bit of a live planning. So I've got an idea of how I want the depot to work. What I would like to do with track planning quite a lot is I'll have a rough idea of I want a four-road depot, I want to have a wash plant, the components of it. Then I need that kind of live planning bit to go, right, okay, how am I going to get the four tracks to the depot? How do I fit in a fueling point? Where's the wash plant going to go? How's it all going to fit together?
Feeling out the track, seeing where it's going to go, I just think that's one of the best phases of a model railway.
Yeah, we'll have all that done very quickly. We'll have the track down, we'll have it wired today.
I better go and set up the camera. Okay, so it's planning time now. I've got a pile of points, got the buildings, I've got my outline for where the main depot building is going to be. So we can imagine that, you know, we'd have a loco standing outside the depot there. I've got to figure out an arrangement for points to meet all the four tracks going into there with a fifth into there as well. And then I need to work out how I'm going to get a return head shunt up to a fueling point over here. And then my brain's ticking at the minute about exactly where I'm going to put the wash plant. So there's got to be a few things to move around, I think, to get this exactly where I want it to be. So I'm thinking kind of storage tanks there, fueling point there, maybe having the wash plant on a separate road there, but with enough space that a loco can stand the other side of it. And then we've got this nice little line side hut, which I think can go with the fueling point as well. We've got the sanding plant there as well. So that was quite quick. Let's have a look at some track. So one of the reasons I put these pencil lines on top of the board for where the frame is it means that I can always make sure my point motor holes don't collide with those frames, because what we don't want is to end up with a point sat straight over the top of a baseboard frame member like that. And equally, I don't want to be getting to a point where, for example, that point ended up across the joint between the two baseboards, because I don't want to have to cut points in half either. So that does add a little bit of restriction to exactly how things could come together. But I mean, even there with those three points, I've now got the basis of the entry to the depot there. They're going to need spacing out a little bit for the track centres, so I think we'll end up with them sort of there and there at this point, but that should give us a decent run into the depot area. So you can imagine you've got your back seat across the end here. So locomotives come in this line here, like I say, they can run down into this area. They can go to the sand plant, or they can run down to a head shunt here. From the head shunt, they can pull forward and go across into the fueling point here as well. or if it's a rival of depot fuel as well, that can come down to the same head shouldn't be propelled back into this siding here. Then if we then put this crossover up at the right hand end here, or the left rather, then once your loco has arrived in the depot on the entry road, it can cross back over here and then it can set back into the depot and be stabled on shed. So for me, that's ticking a lot of boxes so far. I just need another pair of points.
Smith, and I'm the owner of Smith's Model Railways, based in Sheringham in Norfolk, just on the main high street, really really close to the North Norfolk Railway. So we stock from N gauge to O gauge brands like Pico, Graham Farish, Hornby, Batman. Just launched our new loyalty card just after lockdown when we reopened. So we also offer these gift vouchers. You can either contact us via our telephone, email, or with our contact form on our website.
So we stopped for a light lunch.
Yes.
And the set blew down.
Yes, we didn't have enough weight on the cord and we killed it.
There's a joke there about me leaving.
Yes. I didn't go quite as planned, did it?
No, so we're now building this al fresco.
Yeah, al fresco, hoping it doesn't rain, because this is January.
Yeah, well. And this is actually being built outside.
It is currently, yes. Yeah.
That was well planned, wasn't it?
I want to get going, please.
Let's go.
Yeah, okay. Some people want the dinner cooked and served, and somehow that is what they deserve. Narcissists with a runaway self-esteem. But let me tell you, you got to pay your dues before it's all cookies and cream.
When was it a good idea to build a layout outside in January, Mike?
It wasn't. It was meant to be undercover.
Why are we building a layout in January outside?
The cover died.
So the tent died.
Yes.
The Heath Robinson died.
Yes.
And we've used part of the remains of the tent now to cover the layout.
The remains of Heath are now covering the layout again whilst
because
it rains.
Because it's tipping it down a bit.
There's blue sky over there.
Is there?
And I'm just going to be patient for 10 minutes to stand there and get wet.
I love your optimism.
Yeah, put all the dangerous electrical things away so they don't, you know, cause any issues for us.
This might be a good moment to say what we shouldn't do at home.
Well, yeah,
electrics
number one,
outside.
Yeah, number one, don't use electrics outside. Number
when
two,
it's raining.
Don't build a layout outside in January. Number three, cup of tea time.
Yeah, that sounds like a plan.
Yeah. I don't like tea, but to be honest, it's warm at this point. That's probably quite a better thing than standing in the rain here. Luna's being sensible. She's got it.
She's got in there.
Yeah.
Oh dear. I think we should go into the workshop.
Well, you've got any space for one in here.
Oh.
See you later.
I'll go over here then.
There's no end to what you can achieve. That's something else. Now what a fool believe.
Yeah.
I'm Anthony of AGL Model Railway Store in Leighton Buzzard, Bedfordshire. Stock the whole ranges for N00 and O, all the major brands for DC modelers and DCC modelers. We have a full DCC sound install, which can include sound, smoke and lights. We offer a range of Pico 009 exclusives, and we are also UK's biggest importer of Batman USA Thomas and Friends models. Got great links to the M1. We have mail order, which you can order through the website www.agrmodelrailwaystore.co.uk. We're actually just off the Lake Buzzard High Street. We're in High Street Mews. So if you look for Costa Coffee, directly opposite, you can see us and the sign.
So the next step in creating our diesel depot is going to start making the pits to go into the side of the diesel depot. So for these I'm using the classic Pico inspection kit pit, which is an injection molded plastic kit. Really simple to put together, takes a few minutes for each one to go together using a plastic cement. Got to cut some parts with some sprues and we'll be away pretty quickly. I think in total I'm probably going to get through about 8 kits to create the inspection pits inside the depot, and I'll get cracking with the first batch. Okay, so I've got a large pile of kits here, but we're going to focus on one for this part of the project, so if we take away the spares. So inside each one of these kits, you get all the components you need to make the inspection pit, and that actually includes lengths of rail as well. Now, because of the design of our depot, I'm not actually going to use the lengths of rail this time, so I'm just going to put them to one side. Because actually what we'll end up doing is joining multiple kits together to create our inspection pit. So just put those rails to one side, we can make use of them somewhere in the depot later. Essentially what you get is you get your sections of plastic here, and these all join together to make an inspection pit. You can then thread the rail into the rail chairs, and then you can add steps and walkways into them as well. So obviously they're not going to go together as they are at the minute, so the first thing we have to do is trim off the injection moulding pips at each end of one of these, and then we can start fixing them together. So to make that possible, I'm just going to use a large craft knife and try and make the cut as neat as possible. So now I can show you more easily how these actually slot together. So you can see they've got tabs at the top corners here and another tab at the bottom as well. And you literally just slide those together and they actually latch into place. Nice tight fit. So obviously that is two parts joined together, but they're now not fully joined together because we just take them apart again at this point. So that's where the solvent weld adhesive comes in. So we join those two together. Then using a plastic cement, that'll soon make us a permanent bond between those two parts. And then we can literally just keep joining these parts together now. So I'm going to add them all together first, and then we'll run the solvent weld in between them all as well to fix them all together. There we go, that's one section of inspection pit done. Now each one of these kits creates around, well, I can tell you exactly how much it makes a 30 centimeter length of inspection pit. So having built one of those lengths, I'm now going to open up another kit and build another length as well. So we'll get all four rows ready to join together and drop into the track bed. Now that I've finished assembling the pit sections, I can start mocking them up on the layout and seeing how they're going to fit together. So I found that for our length of pits here, I need 2 full kits for each road. So that's quite a significant length of pits. So we're going to join these together just temporarily alongside the tracks so you can see how they fit. And if I just drop them in between the rails there, you can see how they're going to fit in inside the slots that have already been cut inside the baseboard frame there. And again, you can see now that with my six kits completed and assembled, obviously without the steps at the moment, because I thought I'd wait till I got them actually set into the baseball before I did the steps, that they fill through the roads. I've got one more road's worth to make. So the next step now is going to be to take out this section of track from here to here, cut off the sleepers, and then thread the rails all the way through this pit. Now, it's going to be quite a tricky job, but it'll take me a few minutes to do it. We'll get each one done, and then we'll be able to just drop this track back in, join it back onto there, and we'll have a depot pit in place. This pit's now exactly the place where I want it to be when it goes into the layout. Let's double check this end. So I know exactly which sleeper I'm going to cut from, so I've got to cut from that sleeper backwards. So I'll just mark that one, so I know that that's where we need to cut from. So we'll take that to one side. I've got one track pin just to pop out at this end. And then cleverly, I've got a rail joiner here, so I can just detach this piece of track. Harder than it looks. And then turn this over. I've cut the web of the sleeper at the point where I previously marked it. And then I'm just going to make one more check as well. So we know that's our starting point. We need to know where the end point is as well. So that'll be the last one there. So the first thing I do is just take the short set of sleepers off the end, which I'd already marked up. So they'll stay on the baseboard there and they'll fit around the pit. And then I've now got to slide off the rest of these sleepers back up to where I've cut back here. But there's no point trying to do that in one because it's just going to be very difficult. So I'm going to cut the webbing in a handful of places, which means then at least we haven't got to pull all the sleepers off in one go then. We can do it a section at a time. So there we go. Now we've got two bare rails. Now for the really fun bit, we've got to thread those back through all these chairs on the inspection pit now. So I'm going to do it half a section at a time. Okay, so it's a case of threading these rails very carefully through each chair along the inspection pit. Now, it is also important to note that actually these kits are designed for either Code 100 or Code 75 track. So our versions here are to match the Code 75 track we're using on the layout. Then we'll repeat the process with the second set. So the hardest part is getting these both lined up with the first chair on each section of inspection pit. Once you've got them in, as you can see actually, they slide in pretty easily. I thought it was going to take a lot longer than that. The next thing I need to do now is just flip this over the other way up again. So we now need to seal that join between the two sections of the pit. So using the same glue as before, I'm just going to run a little bit into the joint. And now we can add the original sleepers onto this end as well. Then it's a case of dropping the pit into the slot, line it back up with the rails down here. There we go, we have one pit complete and in place. So all I've got to do now is repeat that three more times. Okay, so the next step then is to add in a couple of the extra little details from the inspection pit kits. The first being steps to go at each end. So they just slot in between the sides of the pit kit. Then a little drop of glue down each side to hold them in place. Little walkways to go across as well. So a couple of those in on each one of these.
So one of the first jobs for you today was to fit the Pico pits.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, well, they're I can't have a depot without a drop pit
underneath for locomotive inspection, maintenance, those type of things. We looked at a fair number of different options in terms of how we might go about doing that, including Western Wagon Works' entire drop section for a depot scene. But because this is Code 75 track and there wasn't availability at the time, we started building this off that product for Code 75, I opted to go with the classic Pico inspection pits. Really simple kits to put together, nicely moulded, really neat as well. And basically what I've done is, rather than using the rail sections that come in the kits, I've taken the sleepers off the original Code 75 track that we laid, and then I've slotted these new inspection bits onto the original rails, which means we've got a nice continuous rail all the way through them, and then nice long pits as well. You can have two full-length locos in these pits, which look really nice.
Pits installed very easily, it seemed.
Yes.
Is there anything else, I ask knowingly, left to do in this area?
There certainly is quite a bit left to do in this area. So, for starters, I didn't order quite enough pits. So I need another two kits to do this fourth line here as well. That means that all four of these then will have the full length with a drop pit in the centre of them. Obviously, there's a small amount that they need to be painted. And then the other big job to do in this area is I want a hard standing all the way around underneath the depot footprint as well. And that will actually extend right to the edge of the building to give us a really nice concrete hard standing all around the depot. I've got all that to cut and fit into here as well. So actually at the moment, I haven't actually formally fixed these roads down. So just want a little bit of flexibility in them for the time being so that I can ensure that when we come to do the plastic art around these, actually these are set dead square against each other. I don't want to get into the fussy kind of complicated cuts of plastic art. I want this to all be really simple as possible to do all this. And then once I've got all that done, again, all the hard standing will be painted as well. And then there's a small matter of there's no building currently.
Well, we've got the building somewhere.
We have got the building somewhere. The building's been built at the moment. So you've obviously in previous clips have seen a depot building on here, and you know there's a depot building coming. But we're now building the final versions for this as well.
Fully painted, fully finished.
Indeed, yes.
Should be nice.
Yeah, no pressure.
Well, before we have a depot building on the layout, we should make sure that the layout works.
Well, that was a fairly big task today, actually, to be fair. So actually making sure we've got all the wiring in the right place. So at the end of day two, we nipped inside one board at a time and soldered all the dropper wires on. So I'm hoping then that I've thought it all through correctly and remembered every single place where you need a dropper. Because on a depot layout like this, there's a lot of places where you want to be able to have, essentially want to be able to have a sound-fitted loco sit in any siding anywhere on the layout and be able to tick over and idle. So you want that kind of feeling of the real depot going off. And you can't do that if you don't have every section of track live. So that does mean then adding a lot of dropper wires. And it was a bit of a kind of a head scratcher at times going, I need one here, but I don't need one there. And I need two there, but I only need one here. And then there was the double slip as well, which needed four. So all those dropper wires were on by the time we came to day three. I've then cut all those wires to length underneath. I've created a main bus running underneath the layout, which is like a mains cable running underneath the layout to carry the power from the control system all the way through all the boards. All the droppers are then connected into connector blocks, which link to the main bus feed. And then those dropper feeds take all that power from the bus and feed it out to all the individual sections of the track.
Which is why I'm glad you brought your soldering iron.
Yes, well actually, interestingly, there's only, I think, I did six solder joints on this, that's it. So everything else is already pre-done the other day in terms of soldering with the track. Everything else is just screwed down to join it all together. Nice and simple.
So shall we see if it works and get the 37 running?
Yes, and I'm intrigued to make sure that I've wired up my hex rod juicer right.
Oh. Run us through what the process of operation is on this layout.
Okay, so the storage yard for this, for a start, is a very simple affair. It's literally two tracks. But what we're doing is using DCC Concepts MPD unit. So they're basically like an aluminium cassette that you can lift on and off the track. It means that once it's got locos on the track, we don't have to be handling them a lot. And it makes it really easy to exchange locos in the storage yard very quickly as well. So then the locomotive will enter the yard. And as it comes into the yard, it either comes straight in for fuel or it will go into the depot, depending on what we want to do with the loco. In this instance, we're going straight into the depot, heading in for stabling, and then it's going to have some maintenance perhaps on this loco. A while later, it's coming back out of the depot, runs back up through the point work, then runs down into the head shunt here in order to go onto the fuel road as well. There it then be refueled before it's then dispatched back to the head shunt to go through the wash plant if it's needing a quick spruce up before it goes out into service, and then it can then shunt it out and onto the main line back out to leave the scene.
So even though it is just a end-to-end depot, the operation is quite complex, really.
It is, yeah, because actually, even within that, there's still some complexities, because, for example, if even when you go through the wash plant, you've still got to then do a shunt back into the front of the depot before you can get back out to go onto the exit road, because everything's been complicated by the point where it was on, which is a good thing in terms of operational value. There's other options as well. It's like, for example, if you end up bringing a loco in and staging it in the depot, then you put another two in front of it, because you can easily get three locos in each one of these roads. And then you decide you want to get loco, the first loco out the back of the siding. Then you've got to shift two other locos out first before you can get the third one out to move it around to take it to where you want it to go. So there's lots of scenarios that can play out on this. And we've also got not just locos moving around as well. We've also got fuel supplies coming in, probably with OH hunters and a couple of TTA tanks. So they'll come into the yard and then reverse back into the fueling point to unload their fuel into the fuel storage tanks. You then might have a maintenance train which might be stable on the back road. We might have a DMU occasionally turn up as well. So there's lots of different scenarios that can happen with this layout as well.
Here at Rails of Sheffield, we pride ourselves in being the leading model railway retailer in the UK. We stock all gauges from Z up to 3.5-inch gauge, including the very popular N gauge, 00 and O gauge. Our customers can also benefit from having their models professionally custom weathered. Also available are our exclusive award-winning models. We also cater for those looking for extra value, with over 200 pre-owned items always in stock ready to take away. So come on down to Rails of Sheffield and see our new showroom. You can find us at 21 to 29 Chesterfield Road, Sheffield, S80RL. You can contact us on 0114 255-1436 and also visit us at railsofsheffield.com.
So things are heating up. We've got a working layout.
We certainly have. About time as well. It's a bit cold outside, Bill, and that.
It was, and wet.
And wet, yes, it did rain as well. That's good idea to build a layout outside in January.
So why did we do that when we've got a perfectly good office we could build it in? But
all the tools are at that other workshop. So
yeah.
That workshop's not quite organised yet. So
well, we soldiered through and now we're on to an exciting bit in the next part.
Yes, we're going to move on to start doing the ground cover. And starting to bring this layout to life, because actually what you see behind us is very different to what you've just seen in the last clip of film.
So for everyone at home who wants to follow on for more, remind us where we can see future parts of this build series, and of course where they can get hold of a depot building themselves.
Of course, right, so the full build series is coming out once a week on a Friday on keymodelworld.com on a dedicated page which you'll find below in the description. You can also follow our series in Hornby magazine, starting from the April 2023 issue, that's HM190. And there you'll find an introduction to the series. And then in the next issue, you'll be moving on to build the diesel depot itself. And if you want to buy one of our brand new diesel depot kits, which are exclusively available from the Key Publishing shop, you can do so at shop.keypublishing.com with the through four road shed priced at £85 and the four road shed with the office block on the back priced at £135.
It's all rather exciting, isn't it?
So,
you get everything, you join in.
I must say, actually, I'd love to put these together. I mean, I would say that, wouldn't I?
You usually do.
Yeah, but I did enjoy putting these together. I put them together on a very tight timescale for this video series, but actually it showed how well they can go together. So just as a little idea of how quick they can go together, the office version of the shed, I built and painted in a day. Well, quite a long day, but it was built and painted in a day. So
there's a day and a night in a day.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. That's 24 hours a day, so...
Right, well, we hope you have enjoyed the series so far as well at home. So thank you very much, as ever, for watching. Take care, and we'll see you very soon in the next one. Bye for now.
I'm Jack, and welcome to Hatton's Model Railways in Widnes. Here at Hans, we stock over 13,000 different product lines, and we also have a huge range of pre-owned items ranging from everything from UK outline, USA outline, Japan. You can also sign up to daily notifications, so whenever we add new pre-owned stock, you can go straight to the website and get first dibs on those too. We also offer a trunk service here at Hans that enables you to purchase items and make sure you've secured them. We'll keep them here safely for you, and you can even combine them with other orders and have them all shipped out together. That even enables you to save on postage costs, and it's great for overseas customers as well. So we're here in our curbside pickup lockers, so anyone who is local to Hattons, you can have your order placed online or over the phone and have it placed in one of our lockers, as you see here. Truly easy to just come and collect your key, pick it up any time of day, 24/7, you can come pick up your order. Our customer experience team is available from 9:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m, 7 days a week UK time. You can place orders, query anything, and you can also speak to our product expert team, who are available to give you expert full-on guidance with our entire product range. You can get in touch via email, social media, live chat, or phone.